God's church, His sanctuary, with thanksgiving and praise. Let's begin with a word of prayer as we welcome God into the presence of His house. Father in heaven, you are most welcome here. And thank you for inviting us to be a part of your family. And as we've gathered here today to witness the value of Christian education and the value of knowing you from a very early age so that it makes and marks a path for us as we continue in life, I pray that you will bless and that you will be here and your presence will fill this house. Help us each, give us health, healing, assuage our grief, make all that's wrong right because we know you and love you. Now we put this service in your hands. I pray that you'll anoint each student as they participate, that you will take the fear from their hearts and that you will let them share the abundance that you've placed inside of each one of them. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We would love it if you guys would sing with us. The first one will be on the screen, but it's also in your hymnals. There's Power in the Blood, number 294. Humble thyself and awesome God. And it's not in the hymnal, but it is on the screen.
Thank you.
Our next song will be Amazing Grace. That one is in the hymnal, number 108. 108. My bad. And our last song will be My God Loves Me.
Thank you.
Thank you for singing with us.
God has blessed you in unexpected ways this morning. I was talking with someone just before our service began. In fact, I think it might have been Ms. Turner, our music teacher, and I was telling her how this week I have been so sick. I really have. And it began Sunday afternoon or Sunday night, and I'm not going to walk you through each step, but yeah, you don't need that. But it is a little bit relevant to what we're going to share with you this morning, and to what our spiritual theme is at Central Valley Christian School for this entire year. So anyway, Sunday afternoon, I'm with some students down at Milo Academy for a middle school arts and technology camp, and it's to last Sunday, and then all day Monday, and then until about noon on Tuesday. And I'm down there, and I'm ready to participate and supervise, or whatever it is you do when you take kids down there, and you really don't have any teaching responsibilities. You do what people tell you. So I go to dinner and have a nice dinner with the recruiting coordinator down there, who's an old friend. And then we go to the chapel right after dinner. And I sit down and I make it through two or three of the songs. And I'm just feeling like I have no energy at all. And so I stand up and I walk back to the dorm room and I crawl into bed. And I spend probably more than the next 28 hours in bed. And at one point, my temperature was, and I never went over to the office to get it taken. I guess I just didn't feel like I had the energy to crawl out of bed. But I have at one other time in my life had a temperature in the 103 to 104 range. And most of you know, for adults, that's dangerous. I mean, the core temperature elevates so much that your brain chemistry is altered a little bit so that you can start hallucinating or imagining things legally. Not safely, but you can do it legally. And so I woke up at one point early in the morning on Monday, and I, first of all, was disoriented. I didn't know where I was. And secondly, I started thinking, oh no, I have missed all of Monday, and it's now Tuesday. And so the tool that I really needed at that point was a thermometer to tell me where I was so that maybe I could make a decision to do something more than what I did, which was just get bed rest. So the idea of a thermometer, it really started encouraging me to think, as I was going to speak with you this morning, about faith meters. Do all of you folks, by the way, do you have a standard issued faith meter at home? No? You know, I thought whenever we stepped into the presence of Christ, we had a faith meter with us. Isn't that something that we have? I mean, every time we step into the presence of Christ, aren't we supposed to be made aware of what our relationship is with God? And our relationship with God is nothing if it isn't based in faith. And so that's our spiritual theme, not just this morning, and I hope that you'll see that permeate everything that we share with you this morning. But it's our spiritual theme for the entire year. And so almost everything we do with the kids, whether it's in the classroom, whether it's on extended activities, we call them field trips, I just thought I'd throw some fancy name out there. But everything that we do with the kids, we try to encourage them to examine their faith meter and to see where it is. Unlike a thermometer, though, the faith meter, the higher it is, probably the healthier we are. So I want to welcome you to worship this morning. Please have a prayer with me right now. God, I praise you for these people. I praise you for the faith that they exercise every day. And whether they check it with some make-believe object called a faith meter or not, God, I pray that you make yourself real to them every day in more ways than we can process, because that's who you are. You are infinite. You are unlimited, God. And that includes the way that you help us to exercise our faith, our trust in and our dependence on you. And so we pray that what we do this morning will be pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, I believe it is now time for our children's offering and our children's story. So I'm going to put the introduction hat down. I'm going to pick this one up. And kids, I want to ask you to come forward for a little story that I want to share with you about faith. Yeah, we're going to do that. Oh, have the kids come back and get them back there. Okay, sounds good. Thank you for the help on that one. Nice work, everyone. And everybody out there, thank you for contributing so generously. So can you raise your hands if that looked in any way just a little bit chaotic with the kids collecting and coming up here? Can you? You know, that was all part of the plan. I mean, this was a remarkably well-orchestrated event that we just completed right here. Yeah, we had kids coming from everywhere, and I think every one of them knew exactly when to come up here. It was perfect. Perfect. Nice work, kids. I loved seeing you guys do that. You know, I've often wondered when the first Lamb's offering ever in an Adventist Christian church was taken up. But it was marketing genius, if you want to know the truth. I mean, if there is one thing that we tend to give our hearts for easily, it's for children. And you folks are a living testimony of that, and not just right now, but throughout many, many years, I'm sure. Have you ever wondered what it looked like when the children came to Jesus? Did it look orderly? Did it look chaotic? Did it look controlled? Did it look like the only word you could use to describe it was joy? I so wonder what that looked like, and I so look forward to seeing a picture of that in heaven when it happens again. Children coming to Jesus, the master storyteller. So kids, I want to take just a few minutes and share a quick story with you about faith. And in this case, and I want you guys to repeat after me in just a few seconds. In this case, it was what we can call unwitting faith. That means you don't really know that you're being faithful, but you are. So can you guys repeat that? Unwitting faith. Unwitting faith. I cannot hear you guys. Okay, that's a little bit better. You said that with some conviction. So when I was about 19, I lived down in Eugene, Oregon, which is about 40 or 45 miles away from here. And that's actually where I grew up. But I had a friend, and he had a girlfriend who was playing in a big-time softball tournament down in Reno, Nevada, which was about 8 hours to the south of Eugene and a little bit to the east. And he had a little sports car, and it was in the summertime, and I had a motorcycle. And we were going to take off. Yes, I know, motorcycles, sometimes we wonder what people are thinking when they get on one of those things. But I grew up with motorcycles, and so it just seemed natural to me to have one when I was a young man. So anyway, and my dear mother, I don't know that I've ever told you this story, and so I hope it doesn't arrest your heart. But we took off early one morning, and we drove down to Reno, and that was all fine, and we drove through the desert and on the highways, and we got down there, and we watched his girlfriend and her teammates play some softball games in this tournament with teams from all over the West Coast, and we were there for 2 or 3 days, and after that, we were going to drive down to Los Angeles to spend a week with a friend of his down there. We were going to go to the places like Disneyland and Knott's Berry Farm and the beach or whatever it was, maybe the San Diego Zoo. So we were taking off in the afternoon, and we'd been in the sun most of the day, and so we were a little bit tired. Well, he was in his sports car, and I was in my motorcycle. We took off from Reno, and we drove over to this one freeway, and then we headed south toward Los Angeles. And boy, by the time, and we had been riding, or I'd been riding anyway, he'd been driving all day long, and it was into the night, and it was past midnight. It was close to 3:00 in the morning. And we hadn't stopped for anything other than to go to the bathroom, to get gas, and to get something to eat. Can you imagine that we were fairly tired? We were fairly tired. And here I was on a motorcycle. And I don't know if you kids have driven with your parents into Los Angeles or not, but when you come out of that it's called the Grapevine area, where there are these mountains on the north side of Los Angeles, and you come down and you can get going really fast on some of those freeways. And at 3:00 in the morning, almost no one was on the freeways. And so we were getting a little impatient and probably eager to get to my friend's place. And so we were driving pretty quickly, and I realized I was starting to get pretty tired. And you know how when you can fall asleep for just a few seconds and you'll snap back to it and you feel wide awake again? You guys have never done that in a class, have you? The teacher has been just going, and all of a sudden you're wide awake. And the teacher tells you after school, well, you know, you only had a little bit of drool coming out of your mouth, but your eyes only closed for about 3 seconds, but you must have fallen asleep because now you're wide awake. And, you know, it was really a pretty remarkable thing. Middle of the night, and I'm going around those curves on the freeways into Los Angeles, and I drifted off just for a second or two on a motorcycle at 65 or 70 miles an hour. And I will tell you something, kids. At that point, I had nothing to do with God in my life. God had everything to do with me, because there must have been an angel who grabbed a hold of those handlebars and kept me from wrecking, because God had a purpose for my life, just like he has a purpose for every one of your lives. You know, God was faithful to me, and I was unaware of what was going on. I was unwitting. regarding his faith and his faithfulness to me. And the next thing I knew, I was wide awake on that motorcycle and under control again. And while I had nothing to do with God at that point in my life, there was a part of me that recognized, wait a second, something divine just happened here. God was a hold of those handlebars. So you guys, there will be all kinds of times in your lives when you may be playing or you may be running down the road or you know, through a field with your dog or whatever it is, and you come this close to something that could really hurt you. There will be times in your lives, and one day you'll have a chance to let God show you how his angels put this shield around you and protected you from those things, even though you were unwitting. All right? So let's keep our faith every day, because whether we see it in action or not, God is there for us. All right? Let's go back to our seats, kids.
Good morning. It is time for our tithes and offerings at this time, so if I could get the deacons to please come forward. Our offering, our loose offering today is going to be for our local church budget. If we could bow our heads, please, we'll have a quick offertory prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for the love that you have for us. I just ask that you open up our hearts to receive what you have for us today. It's been such a blessing, and thank you for that. We ask that you're with the congregation as they praise you in offerings now. And so we thank you for that, and we just ask that you're with us today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We have one of our bell choir members who's missing today, and so that's why I'm playing bells. And the next song that we're going to play for you is entitled To a Wild Rose. Oh, and we also have Damon Nussbaum, who is subbing for one of our members who's gone also. Thank you. Which one is your line up? Line up. Line up. Line up. Line up. Line up. sing the choir to go sit down right here. Bobby, you're going to help me now get myself over. Okay.
Do we need help with the mics?
Getting them set.
For our congregational prayer. So if I could just please have you kneel where you are, if you can do that, I'd appreciate that, and we'll have our prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the love that you have for us. Lord, thank you for the beautiful blessings we've already received this morning, and we appreciate that so much. And we're so grateful that the school is here putting on this program. As we see the little children walk forward, we know that we want to lift them up to you. But, Lord, we want to lift up the parents and grandparents to you also at this time. There's such a huge influence in these kids' lives, and we just ask that you continue to work through them and with them to raise these children up. We thank you for our school. They're doing an amazing job out there, and we appreciate that. Lord, we also want to lift up some members to you that have been on our prayer list that need your help and care, and we pray for these people all week long. But also, Lord, we have a couple that we want to lift up to you at this time. We want to lift up Sheila. She's been sick with the flu, and it's been pretty devastating for her, keeping things down and that sort. So we ask that you put your healing arms around her. But Lord, we also want to lift up our brother Lawrence Van Tassel, who has prostate cancer. And Lord, he's trying to get down to Loma Linda to get the treatment. And the insurance has been kind of dragging her feet and making it kind of difficult. So Lord, we just ask that you open up the door so that he can get this treatment and the care that he needs. And I know that you've placed these schools and institutions in place so that we can use them and be better healed, and we just ask that you open up that door for him. Thank you for the many blessings that you've given us throughout the last week. We are thankful for our Spanish group, and Lord, we are just so grateful and happy that you're a God that we can come to every single day, and you're always there for us. So thank you for that. Thank you for loving us as your people, and thank you for giving us this church. I pray in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen.
Today's scripture is from 2 Corinthians 5:17. If anyone belongs to Christ, then he is made new. The old things have gone, everything is made new.
today. God has a rich blessing for us. He said in Revelation 1, verse 3, he said, "Blessed are those that read and those that hear the words of this prophecy and those that keep the things written therein, for the time is at hand." That's a triple blessing. And that's what we're going to receive today, because our little choir is going to do a mini musical on Revelation 21 and the first little bit of 22. And if you'd like to follow along in your Bibles, there's pew Bibles if you don't have one, if you want to follow along as we're singing and speaking this little musical called Our New Home, the New Jerusalem.
The holy city,
the new Jerusalem,
coming down from God out of heaven,
prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying,
"Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them.
And they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them,
and be their God."
Thank you.
unto me one of the
seven angels,
which had the
seven vials
full of them
seven last plagues,
and talked with me, saying, come hither, and I will shew thee the bride, the Lamb's wife.
And had a wall great and high, and had
12 gates.
And at the gates
12 angels.
And he carried me away to a great and high mountain and showed me the city, the new Jerusalem, descending from God out of heaven, descending from God out of heaven.
And had a wall great and high, and had
12 gates.
And at the gates
12 angels.
And the names written thereon, which are the names of
the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. 1.
2.
Reuben.
3.
Gad.
4.
Asher.
9.
Naphtali.
6.
Manasseh.
7.
Simeon.
8.
Levi.
9.
Issachar.
10.
Zebulun.
11. Joseph.
12.
Benjamin.
On the east,
3 gates.
On the north,
3 gates.
On the south,
3 gates.
And the wall of the city had 12 foundations. And in them the names of the
12 apostles of the Lamb.
1. Peter.
2.
James.
3. John. 4.
Andrew.
5.
Philip.
6.
Bartholomew.
7. Thomas.
8.
James of Alphaeus' son.
9. Thaddeus.
6. Matthew.
11. Simeon.
12.
Matthias.
And he that talked with me had a golden reed to measure the city and the gates and the wall thereof.
And the city lies 4 squares.
And the length is as large as a breadth.
And he measured the city with the reed.
12,000 furlongs. Today, by our measurement, that would be 15,000 miles.
Wow!
And the length and the breadth of the height of the equal.
And he measured the wall thereof on 144 cubits.
Today, that would be about 215 feet.
According to the measurement of a man, that is one of the angel.
And the building of the wall of it was of jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass.
And the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass. Whoa!
Cool. And the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones.
Whoa!
The first foundation was
jasper.
The second,
sapphire.
The third,
chalcedony.
The fourth,
an emerald.
The fifth,
sardonyx.
The sixth, sardius.
The seventh,
chrysolite.
The eighth, beryl.
The ninth,
topaz.
The tenth, a chrysoprasus.
The 11th,
a jacinth.
The 12th,
an amethyst.
And the 12 gates were
12 pearls.
Every several gate was of one pearl.
Whoa!
And the streets of the city was pure gold.
As if it were transparent glass. Wow!
Shall not be shut at all by day.
For there shall be no night there.
No night?
For there shall be no night there.
And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it.
And there shall in no wise either into it anything that doth flesh.
Neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie,
but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life.
And he showed me a pure river of the water of life, proceeding from the throne of God and the throne.
Was there the tree of life, which bore 12 manner of fruits and yielded her fruit every month.
The first month.
Cantaloupe.
Or pears.
The second month.
Maybe orange.
Or grapefruit.
The third month.
Maybe watermelon.
Or plums.
The fourth month.
Grapes.
Or cherries.
The fifth month.
Bananas.
Or mangoes.
The sixth month,
apples.
Or papayas.
The seventh month, blueberries.
Or figs.
The eighth month,
strawberries.
Or pineapples.
The ninth month,
peaches.
Or blackberries.
The tenth month,
dates.
Or nectarines.
The 11th month, are maybe fruit that we have never seen, like durian, jackfruit, and egg fruit.
The 12th month,
and I hope there will be new fruits that don't even grow on this earth.
Wow!
And the leaves of the trees were for
healing of the nations.
There shall be no more curse.
See his face.
shall be no night there, and they need no candle.
Neither the light with the sun, for the Lord God giveth them light.
And they shall reign forever and ever.
Behold, I come quickly.
Behold, I come quickly.
Behold, I come quickly.
Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book.
It is done. It is done. It is done.
Good morning. Thank you for giving us your precious children to train and to share God's love with. Our preschool is full with 12 children, and 6 of them are here today, and they wanted to share a little bit with you.
Father, God, and He gave me a smile. He gave me tears and He made me His child. Well, I just thank you, Father, for making me me.
Ecclesiastes 12:13.
Don't worry because I am with you. Don't be afraid because I am your God. I will make you strong and help you. I will support you with my right hand that saves you. Isaiah 41, verse 10. The man who refused to forgive. One day, Peter came to Jesus and asked how many times he should forgive people. Is seven times enough?
But Jesus said, not seven times seven, but 77 times. And when he said that, Peter was surprised.
And then Jesus told him this story.
Once there was a servant who owed a king lots of money. In fact, he owed him millions of dollars. Whenever the king let him borrow more money, he was happy.
So when the king told him he had to pay it all back, he was sad. And he said,
I can't pay you back. I've used it all buying candy bars.
Well, something like that. And then the king got angry.
Then you and your children and your wife are going to be sold as slaves, and you can pay your debt.
When the servant heard that, he was surprised.
And sad, he dropped to his knees and said, oh, please, give me more time. I'll pay it back, I promise.
Well, the king thought about it and decided to cancel that servant's debt and let him go. When the servant thought about it, he was very, very, very surprised.
And happy. But then something unexpected happened. That servant went out and found someone who owed him a couple of dollars, and he got angry.
Pay me my money! I want more candy bars!
And he started choking the poor guy. When he did that, the poor guy was really surprised.
And he was choking.
But then the man dropped to his knees and said,
oh, please, give me more time. I'll pay it back. I promise.
just like the other guy had done.
But instead of canceling that man's debt, he sent him to prison until he could pay the money, and that made the guy really sad.
And when he did that, the other servants were very surprised.
They went to tell the king, and when the king heard about all that, he got really angry.
So once again, he called in the servant who owed him all that money.
You wicked man, I canceled your debt, for you refused to have mercy on this other guy.
When the servant found out the king knew about what he'd done, he was surprised.
And sad.
Because the king was angry.
And not very happy.
So the king sent him to jail.
And believe me, that guy was very sad.
And then Jesus said, that's how God will treat you unless you forgive others from your heart.
Because when you hold a grudge and refuse to forgive it, it makes the Lord angry at the way that we live.
But when we forgive others, God's happy, because then we're treating others like he's treated us.
The end.
Well, we are, I don't know if you could apply a percentage to it or not, but we are probably close to 80 or 90% the way through the worship service this morning. And I pray that you have been blessed in some way. I know that there's been some laughter and maybe even some laughter when it wasn't necessarily the intent to draw out some laughter from you. There's also been some scriptural references. There have been some talents on display. But folks, you know, hopefully it's a sampling of how God can minister to us in so many different ways. And I hope that that's what we've been able to do for you this morning. I know that if you've looked at your bulletin and if you've checked out your clock on your phone or perhaps your wrist, recently you'll see that it's already a quarter after 12 and your bulletin says that it's a sermon. You know what we do in English when we want to make something seem smaller than you might ordinarily expect? We put the four little letters E-T-T-E on the end of it. So I want you to consider this a sermonette, okay, because it's going to be smaller than a sermon. And in fact, it'll be so much smaller, it will be probably no more than 5 to 7 or 10 or 23 minutes. I'm kidding, okay? Really. No, seriously, I don't want to take an awful lot of time, but I do want to accomplish a couple of things with the words that I have to say over the next few minutes. And I believe I have done this with you folks earlier this school year, so if your legs are not loose, let's go ahead and get them that way, because I'm going to ask you to participate just a little bit over the next few minutes with me. Folks, I want to identify people who have at least four different things in common, and I'm going to mention them here in just a moment, but it's a way of helping us to understand that we are a community, and a community that continues to grow. At least that's what I hope is happening. Somebody asked me before the school year began, Mike, what do you think your strength is or your strengths are as a school leader? And the first thing that came to my mind was that, you know, God has really gifted me with the ability of community building. And that happens in a lot of different ways. And I know that I've probably fallen down on the job more than once this year. But I am so blessed to see the community that continues to just expand and expand as we continue to interact with more worship communities. So I have these four different things that I want you to stand if they apply to you. First of all, please stand if you have ever talked about faith with someone else. And after every one of these statements, after you stand, would you please just look around and see who is part of that faith community with you? Would you just look around? Oh, it's you. You're part of the faith community. Very good. Please sit down. Do I seem like I'm contradicting myself? Please stand. Please sit down. Please stand. Please sit down. That kind of thing. Trust me, there's a point to it. Number two, please stand if you have ever been unsure if someone you loved was safe. Yeah. And again, please look around and see how many of you share this same situation where we have to exercise faith. All right, please be seated. Should I move a little faster for you kids? Up, down? Well, that's too bad. It's going to go at my pace, okay? Number three. Please stand if you have ever had someone surprise you with an unexpected gift. Well, I certainly hope so. And you know what? If you're not standing right now, you should talk with someone who loves you and say, I'm expecting an unexpected gift at some point. Please be seated. And then the last one, at least in this section, please stand if you have ever been able to help someone who had no way to repay you. God bless you. All right, please be seated. So folks, every one of these four situations that I shared with you, and I asked you to stand or not stand if it didn't apply to you, it involves faith in some way. I want to also express faith in another way by saying thank you to you folks this morning. And so I want you to stand if one of the descriptors applies to you that I'm going to mention here, and I want you to remain standing. And after we're done, we want to give you an extra thank you. So we want to share or express thanks to you if you have ever attended, not currently, but if you have ever attended Central Valley Christian School as a student. Not currently, I said. So all of you guys who are students right now, you can remain seated, okay? Okay, so remain standing, please. Remain standing. Second one, please stand if you have ever volunteered at or in order to help Central Valley Christian School. You guys will get your chance, okay? We also teach impatience at school every day. Well, actually, we don't have any control over that. It's just this organic thing, and it happens. The third item here, if you have ever worked at or for Central Valley Christian School, would you please stand as well? Oh, please remain standing if one of the earlier ones applied to you as well. And then finally, well, actually, there are two more. So here is the second to the last one. If you either are a student or you have a student at Central Valley Christian School, would you please stand? And finally, if you have ever lifted Central Valley Christian School before God in prayer, would you please stand as well? Folks, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for what you have done and what you continue to do every day to build the Central Valley Christian School community. We appreciate you. Please give yourselves a hand if you would. All right, please be seated. Thank you so much. I promise that's the last time I will ask you to stand as part of this sermonette. Hey, the last thing I want to do as I bring this sermonette to a close this morning is I want to ask you to consider what it is that makes a Christian school a reflection of Christ. And all of us can answer that in so many different ways. You know, it may be acts of service. It may be the fact that you can walk down the hallway and you see words of faith on the walls or coming out of children's or staff members' mouths or a number of other responses to that question. You know, I've had some conversations with people over the last couple of months or so, and we talk, and there are people who live in the Central Valley here, area here, and they talk about the school. They ask, well, how big is the school? And I share some numbers with them. Numbers. You know, numbers sometimes seem to get in the way of our walk with God, whether it be in a school, whether it be in a church, or whether it be in conversations, whatever it is. But they'll ask what the size of the school is, and I'll share those numbers with them. And more than once, the reaction has been, "Oh, I'm sorry." You're sorry for what? You know, I taught in public education for more than 15 years. More than 75% of my professional career as an educator has been in public education. And interestingly enough, on the way up here this morning from my mom's house in Eugene, we were talking about education, and she has some grandchildren, actually great-grandchildren, who are attending public education in Eugene. And my niece, their mother, they actually moved from the Houston, Texas area. And you know, if you were to talk about the financial well-being of public education, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on public education, but I do feel the need to talk about it for just a moment or two here. If you were to compare the financial well-being of public education in Texas, and Houston is a massive metropolitan area, it's even bigger than where I used to live in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and you compared it with public education in Oregon, and I am not here to bash public education in any way. Thank the Lord for public education. It is so many people's only opportunity to improve themselves. It really is. But if you were to compare the financial well-being of the two, it would almost be like comparing a mansion with a public restroom. The abundance is so obvious in so many places down, or so many communities down in Texas. And in Oregon, there just are not that many school districts where there is abundance, where they have enough. As a result, you have so many classrooms in Oregon public schools where, and I'm talking middle school and high school, first of all, and I'll talk about elementary school here in a moment, but you have so many classrooms where students are in a classroom with 35 to 40 or 45 or 50 other children in that classroom. And you know, the largest classes I have ever had are in the low 40s. 43 was the biggest class I ever had. And the first day of school, all of these 43, 16 and 17 year olds come, you know, dragging themselves into my classroom. And as it turned out, I had them sitting on tables in the back of the room, and I had two chairs back at my desk area, and they were sitting there and the kids, the space between the aisles was often about this. I mean, what is that, 14 to 16, maybe 18 inches between the two. And that happens in so many classrooms in Oregon. So people, when they have responded to my telling them, you know, how many students we have, and they say, "Oh, I'm sorry," I actually start to not necessarily feel sorry for them, but I start to wonder, what is it that you're sorry for? You know, my idea of a Christian school, and I'm still a little bit of a newbie to Christian education, even though I attended a Christian school for 6 years when I was a kid, but my idea of a Christian school is not connected in any way with how big it is. So whether it's 10 kids or whether it's 1,000 kids, and yes, there are Christian schools out there with more than 1,000 students in them, but whether it's one or the other, if it's a school that in every way and every day emphasizes and tries to reflect the character of Jesus Christ, then it is a school that deserves to be respected, a school that deserves to be admired. And folks, that is our leading priority every day at Central Valley Christian School, is to be a reflection of Jesus Christ in whatever ways He asks us to do that. So for every prayer that you have offered, for every dollar that you've donated, for every hour that you've contributed of your time, and there are many of you who fit those descriptors and more, thank you so much for helping us as a ministry at Central Valley Christian School to impact our local community. By the grace of God, hopefully we continue to do that. Thank you. Folks, we're going to do something just a little bit different with our benediction this evening, and I'm going to introduce that now. Ms. Anita Bates, our kindergarten, first and second grade teacher, has prepared a beautiful blessing, a scriptural-based blessing from the Psalms for you as we send you off from this worship experience. And I'm going to have you go ahead and come on up. And then when we are done, I'm going to close with a prayer. You have invited folks to sing along with you, right?
Yes, please.
So if God's Spirit moves you to do that, please join in.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Kids, can we pray? Let's pray. God, I praise you for the precious time we have had here on this day of renewal, this sanctified day you have offered to us. God, I praise you for every person in this building right now, and the prayers and the contributions and the volunteer work that they have offered so freely to bless Central Valley Christian School. I pray this morning that as we've offered our gifts in return to them, that you have taken them and turned them into something beautiful, so that these people as well have been blessed by our time with them today. Please take each one of these people now, as we walk out that door, fill them with your Holy Spirit, so that as they interact with the people you will bring into their lives in this week to come, those people will leave their presence knowing that they have stepped in front of the Lord because your Spirit works through them so powerfully. God, keep each one of us faithful until we meet again. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.